Welcome to Nightcap. I'm Claire Duffy. We have a great show for you today. First up, Ozempic is in short supply. Diabetics who need it can't get it. We'll explain why. Then, a real-life succession. A new book depicts the dysfunction inside the Redstone media empire. And last, we explore what really went wrong with the once popular live game show app, HQ Trivia. Click on the chapters below. But first, you've heard the commercial.
Oh!
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 People with type 2 diabetes are excited about the potential of once-weekly Ozempic.
People with type 2 diabetes may be excited about it, but it turns out they can't actually get their hands on it. That's because Ozempic is in short supply thanks to surging demand for an off-label use, weight loss. It turns out Ozempic and Wegovy, the same drug actually approved for slimming down, may be the long-sought cure for obesity, helping people lose an average of 10 to 15% of their starting weight. Ozempic has become a social media phenomenon, fueled by celebrity mentions and speculation over who's taking it. Just recently, comedian Chelsea Handler said she didn't even realize she was on Ozempic, since her doctor just, quote, hands it out to anybody. But have these drugs changed the definition of being thin and what it takes to get there? That's what Matthew Schneier asked recently in an article for New York Magazine. Matthew, you called this the Ozempic moment and talked about the tension between people who need this drug and may not be able to get it versus those who want it but maybe don't need it. Can you explain what's going on here?
Yes. Ozempic is a drug that was approved in 2017 for the treatment of diabetes 2. And in treating the diabetes, incidentally, has this one of the side effects is pretty significant weight loss, which is very, very appealing to many people in America and around the world. And so while the drug is technically only meant to be prescribed for diabetics for treating their diabetes, the people realizing that there may be significant weight loss benefits are flocking to their doctors to get it prescribed off-label, and in some cases flocking to external providers who may not even be doctors to get it on the gray and black market. So yes, there have been shortages over the past year. The companies are saying that these shortages are being addressed and have been addressed, but there may still be, you know, kind of lagging availability in intermittent supply issues.
Sort of on that point about access, Ozempic costs about $1,000 a month if your insurance doesn't cover it. And you also profiled someone who got the generic ingredients for $625 a month, still a hefty chunk of change. Even Elon Musk, the world's richest man, has talked about using Wegovy for weight loss. Are these drugs only available to the rich and famous and privileged?
Well, I would say they're available to those who are willing to pay for them, whether they're rich, famous, and privileged or not. At this point, the active ingredient in Wegovy and in Ozempic is called semaglutide, is under patent. The Danish pharma company Novo Nordisk has that patent until 2031, 2032, depending on where you are in the world. And they have the right to kind of charge what they want. Now, in terms of the actual sort of consumer end of it, I spoke with people who were getting it for all different prices, whether they were getting it from other countries, whether they were getting resold prescriptions that had been covered by insurance. I'm not sure. They weren't sure. And in many cases, they didn't care. What I heard over and over again was this drug was worth to them whatever it cost them to acquire it.
So interesting. So what is the demand for these drugs such that you can have a hard time getting your hands on them? Say about this moment in culture and our relationship with our bodies and self-image. I thought it was interesting you asked in your article, aren't we supposed to have moved on from this?
Right. I mean, I think over the past several years, there's been a lot of talk in the media, certainly, and feeling culturally that we are now in a moment of body acceptance, body positivity, size inclusivity. You saw ad campaigns with men and women of all different shapes and sizes. We were supposed to have moved on from the restrictive body standards, that governed and I think to some degree oppressed us all, for many years before then. And this moment, the availability of essentially a kind of silver bullet that, may help lose a significant amount of weight with a minimum of effort, I think gives the lie in some way to the idea that we're kind of over body standards and that we're ready to sort of love and accept everybody.
Up next, imagine a drama about a family-run media empire with an aging mogul facing off in a power struggle with his kids.
You cannot win. Your dad will wash you away.
This is a chessboard.
Are you tanking the deal?
And every move is crucial. Like Israel-Palestine, Greg, but harder and much more important.
No, not Succession. This was Sumner Redstone, the fading billionaire who controlled a media empire that included Paramount, CBS, and Viacom. But Sumner had a weakness, women, who in the story that tabloids told in lurid detail, controlled his life and attempted to wrest control over his vast media empire from his family. What followed was a bizarre and fascinating tale that includes billions of dollars, con men, soap opera stars, Me Too, and details that will make your head spin. A new book, Unscripted, The Epic Battle for the Media Empire and the Redstone Family Legacy, dives deep into the sordid and wild tale. Rachel Abrams is a reporter for the New York Times and one of the book's authors. She joins us now. You reported this story for your book for 3 years. For someone who didn't follow this while it was happening, why is this story important?
So this story is fundamentally a family drama that a lot of people are going to be able to relate to. I think that people think often that business stories are about purely business and divorced from the people who run the companies. But as this story shows, this is a story about fundamentally flawed people and a dysfunctional family dynamic that a lot of people are going to understand and really, it's really going to resonate. And what I mean by that is, at its core, this is a story about a father and a daughter, a father who often withheld love and affection from a daughter that always craved it. And that dynamic shapes not just their relationship, but the future of a multi-billion dollar media empire that controls companies like CBS, Viacom, Paramount, MTV, Nickelodeon, brands that all of our audience is going to be familiar with, and more importantly, brands that shape the shows and the films and the products that that shape our culture. So these are very influential people, and fundamentally, it's a story that I think is going to resonate with the audience.
There's so much here. I wonder what was the most surprising thing you learned in the course of your reporting this book?
So the book is about Sumner Redstone in his waning years. He's one of the most important media moguls of the 20th century, 21st century. And the book is basically about when he becomes older and vulnerable and more infirm, these sort of would-be paramours, girlfriends who move into his life and come very close to taking over his companies and wresting control away from his daughter. And, you know, this man was worth billions of dollars. And the thing I found really surprising is that there weren't more guardrails around him that would keep hangers-on and sycophants out. And in fact, it was very human themes of loneliness, the vulnerability of old age, the desire for companionship that allowed these girlfriends or companions to really come into his life and end up with more, at least $150 million of his money. And I just, you know, it just makes you think, like, if it could happen to Sumner Redstone, you know, if there aren't guardrails around him, then, you know, why wouldn't it happen to somebody with far fewer resources and far less wealth?
It is such a good question. If it can happen to him, who won't it happen to? I wonder, all of this drama is very reminiscent of HBO's Succession. Redstone's relationship with his daughter, Sherry, who now runs the empire, was famously contentious. Is it fair to compare Succession to the Redstones, or was this real life even stranger than fiction?
I mean, if you like Succession, you will love this book, but I would argue that the book is even weirder than the show, because our book is about the fight for this family media empire. So you've got similar themes, you've got similar ideas as the television show, but the dynamics are extremely strange, and the characters are I would argue, wackier. I mean, our reporting over 3 years took us across a cast of characters, including a not very good con man living in Arizona who used to be a soap opera star. We've got Bravo's millionaire matchmaker in there. Some might be familiar with Patty Stanger. She's a millionaire matchmaker to the stars. You've got this multi-billion dollar media family. I mean, you really couldn't make up some of the people who were involved in this multi-billion dollar fight for Viacom and CBS. It's really quite remarkable. So I think the comparisons are fair, but truth is often stranger than fiction.
And last, remember HQ Trivia? The live game show app became a phenomenon, allowing users to compete against each other and win cash prizes. At its height in 2018, it had more than 2.3 million players.
HQ Trivia was everywhere.
It is that time once again. The quizzing hour is upon us.
People played it on the subway, at home, at work, in the bar.
Three winners, baby. HQ.
But then, suddenly, downloads of the app plummeted. How did such a popular game crash and burn? Glitch, The Rise and Fall of HQ Trivia, a new documentary from CNN Films, explores what went wrong. Scott Rogowski was one of HQ Trivia's hosts, known as Quiz Daddy, and he joins us now.
Hello.
Scott, I remember when everyone was obsessed with HQ. What made it so popular, seemingly overnight?
There were a lot of factors that went into the popularity. I think one of them was just the fact that this was a kind of a new technology at the time, right? A live stream game that you can play on your phone, mobile, that was important, right? And it was interactive. So what you weren't just watching a game show like people watch Jeopardy and shout out questions. They got to actually be a contestant on Jeopardy from the comfort of their phone, wherever they were, out and about, at basketball games, at weddings. I saw people send me text, you know, tweets from playing HQ all over the place. But you had to be in it to win it. And it was a live game with an appointment. So there was like a starting line. Everybody started there at the beginning. And if you're the last person standing, you won money. We gave away free money. That was a big factor too. So it was an entertaining, fun game, quick 15-minute thing to do on your phone. Why not?
Scott, people say HQ Trivia fell apart because of corporate clashes, CEO leadership problems, lack of innovation, and even increased competition, as you mentioned. What do you think ultimately led to its downfall?
Well, I think, you know, it's a soup, a gumbo of all those things. I ultimately think that, you know, the lack of innovation is a key thing here. And when you think about the game itself, it was 12 questions. You had to answer them all to win. If you got a question wrong, you were out. You couldn't keep playing even. So the product itself needed some work. But beyond that, we didn't have new games. We could have had HQ, dating shows, HQ judge shows. And we had these things in the pipeline. Don't get me wrong. There were a dozen different concepts we were working on behind the scenes, but because of the management at the time, our leadership, we just were not able to, the team, I should say, I wasn't really working on this, but the engineers, the coders, the designers, they could not get these products shipped because of what was going on at the top, which this film definitely delves into. So you should watch the full story.
I think I would like to see a Quiz Daddy dating show coming up soon.
Hey, in another universe, it's happening. In a parallel universe, it's happening right now.
The CNN film Glitch, The Rise and Fall of HQ Trivia, premieres Sunday, March 5th at 9 p.m. Eastern. That's all from us. Don't forget to sign up for the Nightcap newsletter at cnn.com/nightcap. And join us again next week at 4 p.m. Eastern time here at CNN Business.